Hey guys, welcome to my channel, Work Biology Out. I hope you guys are safe and doing really great. I'm Jessica, and today I'll be sharing with you guys a detailed explanation of DNA replication. Now watch this video till the end, because I've got something for you. Now before we start, I'd like you to subscribe, like this video, because that way it reaches more people, and also share it with your friends if you find this video helpful. Now, let's get to work. Now the first question which comes to mind is, what is DNA replication? The definition goes like, it is a process of duplication of DNA, that is, the synthesis of new complementary strands of DNA from the template strands. Now complementary strands are those strands which have their base pairs complementary to that of the template strand, and template strand is the one which needs to be replicated. Complementary, you understand, like A, if there's A on the template strand, then there would be T on the complementary strand. Okay. Now I'm drawing here a segment of DNA comprising of two strands. These two DNA strands after replication would form four strands, as you can see here. Now the blue colored ones are the newly synthesized strands, and the pink and the black one are the parental strands. The sequences of base pairs in the complementary strands is dependent on the sequences of the base pairs in the parental strands. Therefore, these two, red and black one, are known as template strands, and the newly synthesized ones are known as complementary strands. All right. Now from this diagram you can see, we started with two strands and we ended up with four strands, which means the amount of DNA doubles at the end of replication, and this replication takes place in the S phase of cell cycle, which we'll talk about in a minute. Now the question comes as to why this process takes place. What is the significance of it? Now you see, one of the main characteristics of living things which differentiate them from non-living is growth. Now growth can be of two types. It can be increase in cell size or an increase in number of cells. The increase in number of cells takes by the process of cell division, which in itself is a whole different topic. But for now, let's just see that cell division can be the meiotic or mitotic. But in both the types, the basic phases of cell division remains the same. Now, as a result of this division, a parent cell divides into two daughter cells. All right. Okay. Now, during cell division, the cytoplasm as well as the genetic material of the parent cell divides. And before this division, the genetic material replicates so that it can be distributed among the daughter cells. Now there are many phases in a cell cycle, G0, G1, M phase, but there's only one phase in which replication of DNA takes place, and that is the S phase or the synthesis phase, because in this phase duplicated DNA is synthesized. Now let's talk about what are the substrates which are required for replication. The basic substrates which are involved in replication are, number one, DNDPs. Now DNDPs are deoxyribonucleotide triphosphates. Now these are of four types: DADPs, DTTPs, DGTPs, then DCTPs. DATP stands for deoxyadenosine triphosphate. DTTPs stands for deoxythymidine triphosphates. DGTPs are deoxyguanosine triphosphates, and DCTPs are deoxycytidine triphosphates. Now, Now these have dual purpose, which I'll talk about later. So the first substrate is DNTPs. Now coming to the next substrate, which are enzymes. Now a number of enzymes are involved in replication. The first one is DNA-dependent DNA polymerase, or simply DNA polymerase enzyme. I'm writing the names first, and I'll talk about their functions as we go into the process. Then there's primase, DNA ligase, helicase, then topoisomerase, and lastly, single-stranded binding proteins, which are also known as SSBPs. Now let's talk about the steps involved in replication. So there are basically three steps in replication. The first one is initiation step. Okay, I'll need the names of the enzymes here, so just, yeah, good. Okay. There is a definite region known as origin of replication where replication begins. Now prokaryotes such as E. coli have single origin of replication, but eukaryotes have multiple origin of replications in order to replicate such huge genomes. Now this origin of replication is identified, and then an enzyme known as helicase binds to it. Now I am drawing here a segment of DNA. Now suppose the helicase enzyme binds to it, then the dotted portion will open up and form a replication fork. Alright, writing the polarity is very important, and you know these two strands are anti-parallel. Now this is the direction of movement of replication fork. Now imagine a coil string. So you see, it will supercoil in the direction in which you will open up the string. This supercoiling is prevented by topoisomerase enzyme. Now you see, the bases between these two strands interact with the help of hydrogen bonds. Due to this interaction, these strands tend to recoil, and this recoiling is prevented by SSBPs. Alright, now this enzyme DNA polymerase is DNA dependent, means that it requires a DNA template to act. Also, it requires a primer, which is synthesized by enzyme primase. Now a primer is a short segment of RNA. Now DNA polymerase enzyme adds nucleotides in the direction 3' to 5' of the template strand. Due to this property, it continuously synthesizes DNA for the template strand which is in 3' to 5' direction. But for the other strand, which is in the opposite direction, the replication is discontinuous. Now the strand for which continuous replication takes place is known as leading strand, and the other strand for which discontinuous replication takes place is known as lagging strands. I'm also writing the type of replication here. Alright. Now these fragments that you see are known as Okazaki fragments, which are later joined by the enzyme ligase. And each Okazaki fragment has its own primer. Now this process of adding nucleotides by DNA polyenzyme to the primer is known as elongation. And the last step is termination. Now replication is terminated when two replication forks meet each other. Now there were two scientists, namely James Watson and Francis Crick, who also gave the double helical structure of DNA. So they suggested that this process of replication is semi-conservative in nature. This was later experimentally proved by Matthew Meiselson and Franklin Stahl in 1958, and their experiment is very popular and is also known as Meiselson-Stahl experiment. Now this semi-conservative replication means that in a duplicated DNA molecule, one strand would be parental and the other one would be newly synthesized strand. This one is the parental and this one is the newly synthesized. Now what they did was they grew E. coli in a culture medium. Now nitrogen is present in our DNA bases, and N14 is the light or the normal nitrogen, and N15 is the heavy isotope of nitrogen. Now the culture medium which they used contained NH4Cl with the heavy nitrogen. This became the source of nitrogen for many generations. As a result, N15 was incorporated into newly synthesized DNA. Then they transferred the cells into a medium with normal NH4Cl with the light nitrogen and took samples at various definite time intervals. Now they used something known as density gradient centrifugation, which helped them to separate the samples on the basis of their densities. And for this particular experiment, they used cesium chloride density gradient. Alright. Now they found that the DNA from one generation after the transfer of N15 to N14 had a hybrid or intermediate density, but the one from second generation contained equal amounts of hybrid and light DNA. Now I told you that DNDPs have a dual purpose in this process of replication. So the first one is that they act as substrates, and the next one is that they provide energy for DNA synthesis. Now you may ask how? So for that, I'm drawing here a basic structure of a DNTP. This is the sugar molecule. Here is the base, which can be anything, A, T, G or C. And to this carbon molecule, three phosphate groups are attached. Alright. They are named as alpha, beta and gamma. Now this is the basic structure of a DNTP. Okay. Now let us assume that this DNA strand needs to be replicated. Here is the primer. Now the 3' end of this primer contains a free OH group. Now this OH group attacks the gamma phosphate group of the triphosphate, and the remaining two phosphates, also known as pyrophosphate, are released from the triphosphate. As a result of this, the gamma phosphate binds to the 3' end of the primer, which ultimately adds a new nucleotide to this growing end. Now this pyrophosphate is hydrolyzed by an enzyme known as pyrophosphatase into two inorganic phosphates, and the energy released is used to bind the gamma phosphate group to the 3' end of the growing end. And this is the driving force for DNA synthesis. So that was it for today's video, guys. I hope you guys liked it. And now you can go and check in my description box, because there I've attached a link to the PDF of notes of this topic which I prepared for you guys. I'll see you in the next video. Till then, stay safe and take care. Bye-bye.